In November last year, I found myself walking on the only road on South Tarawa, the capital of the remote Pacific Island nation of Kiribati. My mission? To look for healthy and nutritious food to cook. For 3 kilometers, I walked past stall after stall, and they were all selling the same items. Bags of white rice, packets of instant noodles, tins of corned beef, and the occasional fish. Not much of a choice. Suddenly, in the distance, I saw a sign, fresh veggies for sale. I quickly ran towards the fuel depot it was pointing to, and they were selling frozen veg. Ah, well, I bought a bag anyway and took it home. At least I had a freezer. Most people in Kiribati do not have the luxury of refrigeration. Why am I sharing this story with you? Well, this is a story typical of atoll communities around the world. Atolls are coral islands with poor soils, 1 to 2 meters above sea level, 200 to 300 meters wide. This makes them highly climate vulnerable. However, what if I were to tell you that climate change is linked to expanding waistlines in Kiribati? You might think it's far-fetched, but there is a link, and that link is food security. You see, as sea levels are rising, salt water is entering the fragile aquifers of the atolls in Kiribati, destroying them and making them bad for growing of crops. Similarly, king tides sweep over entire swathes of the island once or twice a year, destroying crops and vegetable gardens in their wake. This, obviously, is a big problem, and people are becoming increasingly reliant on importing food. But because they have low purchasing power, the food that they get is of very poor quality, high in fats, salts, and sugars. The impact on their health is devastating. 45% of the people in Kiribati are now obese. 25% have diabetes, and it is rising. High blood pressure is through the roof. So we know that there are problems, we know the statistics, but what about the people on the ground? Why are the communities in Kiribati abandoning a traditional healthy diet in favor of an unhealthy one that characterizes them today? Is it economic reasons? Is it perhaps that climate change is making the crops they like to grow impossible to grow? Is it cultural preference? Perhaps is it a matter of taste or a cultural perceived glamour over the food? This is where my research comes in. Through focus groups and household surveys, I hope to get to the crux of this problem and help the people of Kiribati have better lives, have healthier lives, and become more climate resilient. Thank you.